Good evening and a very warm welcome to 10th Church. We're glad to have you with us. If you're regular attenders and members, it's great to be together. And if you're new, and maybe you've only been here a few times, we're very glad that you are joining with us tonight. If you are new, if that's your case, we do have a welcome desk just behind the sanctuary here. We'd love to share information about the church with you. We'd love to get to meet you that way. You can also introduce yourself to us using these cards that will be in the rack in front of you, and we'd love to get to know you that way. There are plenty of announcements in your bulletin about activities over the next week or so. One that I will flag for this evening is immediately after this service, 10th City Network, our 20s and 30s ministry, will be hosting TCN After Hours, just a brief time of fellowship and food and singing and reading the scriptures and praying together. So you'd be welcome to come to that immediately after the evening service in 1710, just next door. So you can go through this door or through the street.
Our call to worship comes from... There you are. Our call to worship comes from 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. You are a holy, a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Great God and Father, what a marvel it is to consider how the wonder of the gospel, that you called us, those who were enemies of you, those who in their hearts were hostile towards you, you made us your own, calling us out of darkness that we would proclaim the wonders of our great God. This evening, as we come, may we respond in our hearts to your call to lift up your name, that your name would be revered and hallowed in this place. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
If you would turn with me now in your bulletins to the prayer of confession, prepare to confess our sins with one another, knowing that the scriptures tell us that if we confess our sins to one another and pray for one another, that we will be healed. So let us pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, we confess that we have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts, and have offended against your holy laws. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And Christian, this is the gospel's assurance of pardon for you. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. Seated.
Let us unite our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. Ever blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we, your creatures here below, gathered with the heavenly hosts, brought by the Spirit to your temple, we desire now to be ready to hear you speak in the reading and in the preaching of your word. Some of us have come like stony paths where the seed of your word would fall and be snatched by the birds as we allow it to pass by us and as we forget it. Some of us have come as rocks, distracted by great suffering and trial. Some have come as thorny ground, distracted by all kinds of cares and even pleasures of this world. But we ask, O Lord, by the power of your Spirit, would you please make us all like the good soil in which the seed would grow and bear fruit for your glory. In Jesus' strong name we ask, amen. Please turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 3 and verse 21. You'll find that on page 941 in the Black Bibles in the pews. Romans chapter 3 and verse 21. And we'll be reading to the end of the chapter. Romans 3:21. But now, the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law? Or is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles also? Yes, of Gentiles also, since God is one, who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith. Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? By no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law. This is God's word.
Let us pray. Dear Father, we thank you for your unceasing grace, for the forgiveness of sins, communion with the saints, and for every spiritual blessing that we enjoy because of Jesus' blood poured out for us. Dear Father, give us pure hearts and good conscience as we give back a portion of what you have given us. May our giving be done with joy overflowing. Bless these gifts and offerings and use them for the advancement of your kingdom in our hearts and in the hearts of those around us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
This evening, I noticed a most beautiful and quite interesting line in our prayer of confession that we pray together this evening, and I'll read it for us. It says, "We confess that we have followed too much the devices and desires of our hearts and have offended against your holy laws." Prayer of confession is the prayer that we as the church pray. If you've been in the Church of Christ for a little while, you've probably come across a teaching that says that the law of God has been done away with for Christians. We are under grace now. There is no longer any obligation, no restraint, no sense of real duty for the church. We are free. Blissfully free. I occasionally note that many folk that hold to such a teaching often appear to be what might be deemed recovering legalists, having grown up in a church or else in a Christian home where it was a wrong understanding of the gospel and of the law. And in many senses, what has happened now is that they are in large reaction against that. And now there is no law for the church, so it said. Tonight we're going to have a look at the place of the law in the light of the gospel. And friends, this could very much have been me. In my early teens, denim jeans were said to be a sign of rebellion. The 4/4 rock beat was deemed to be demonic. And one of the major issues in the church back in the mid-80s was that if you played certain records of the time backwards, there would be hidden demonic messages. And so when I got my ear pierced at the age of 21, well, let's just say it's a wonder that I'm here today. Friends, this teaching can take a variety of forms, but in general, generally, it is summarized as follows. If you are in Christ, the law of God has been abrogated. It's been done away with. It's been made void. Obedience to the law is said to be an old covenant, an Old Testament reality, and we now are the new covenant people of God. We are those who are under grace. Christ has fulfilled the law of God on our behalf. In other words, the law of God is no longer binding for Christians. The law is said to be a kind of bygone relic of a previous age, a relic that should absolutely not be dusted off and used in our current time. You've probably heard one of these pithy statements in Christianity today, something like, Christianity is about grace, religion, the law. What about, God does not need your good works, your neighbor does. And then we have that classic one, we are no longer under the law, but under grace. But that's actually Romans 6, verse 14. What's fascinating to know is that not only does Paul say that the believers are no longer under the law, in the very next chapter, in chapter 7 and verse 4, he says that we have died to the law through the body of Christ. And so Paul clearly says that we are not under the law. We died to it in dying with Christ. Yet, 3 chapters earlier, at the end of our text tonight, Paul says in the very same letter that the law of God is not done away with. We are to uphold the law. And so thus, what is actually going on here? Which is it? Are we no longer under the law? Are we to uphold the law? Surely Paul cannot be contradicting himself. We remember in terms of what Scripture is. It is most basically the Word of God. We do not prize some text of Scripture only to reject or move beyond others. Last week, we found that the beauty of the gospel is seen in the fact that wrath-deserving sinners have been made righteous by the obedience of another, of Christ. Salvation of sinners is the work of God alone. It does not come through your or my perfect obedience, but it is a gift of God, a gift of true grace, a work of God. And after masterfully describing how it is that this is the case, Paul then turns in our text tonight to the issue of boasting. And he does so because he wants to drive home the reality that there is no shadow of a doubt that salvation is in Christ alone, and that you and I contribute nothing to our salvation. It is by faith and faith alone. Salvation is a gracious gift. And right towards the end of our text, in verses 27 through 28, we see that Paul reiterates this understanding by raising three hypothetical questions so as to cut the legs from under the very arguments, the boastful claims of meriting one's salvation by anything that you and I might do. And so we find, as we read here in verse 27 through 30, then what becomes of our boasting, Paul writes, it is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Or is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles also? Yes, of Gentiles also, since God is one. Who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith? Paul is covering every base here. Step by step, he is removing every possible claim that any one of us might have to claiming salvation with Christ plus something else. Each of these questions is designed to highlight the fact that there is absolutely nothing native to the believer that can contribute or that warrants God's kindness. No good behavior, no good intentions. And he presses the point home still further, and he eradicates any so-called biases that we might think we might have. A bias due to ethnic or cultural or religious or social standing. None of these, not a single one, has any ground or is any merit towards causing God to look favorably upon you. And if there is to be any boasting whatsoever, Paul says, then we will boast in Christ and in his cross, and boast in that alone. See, Paul could hardly be any more emphatic. He wants to press the point home as far as he possibly can. He wants to thoroughly shut the door to any contribution that you and I can make to our salvation. The law cannot and does not save sinners. Only Christ does, by faith. And after those three hypothetical questions, pushing and driving this point home, Paul switches gears Paul anticipates an objection. He anticipates an objection of someone raising their hand in the crowd, so to speak, and saying, "Excuse me, Paul, if the righteousness of God has been manifest apart from the law, does that not then mean that the law of God itself has been overthrown by faith?" In other words, if salvation is apart from the law, isn't the law then done away with? See, Paul realizes and recognizes that some are going to come to the assumption that if the law is done away, then we are no longer in need of that law, and the law is being nullified. And Paul's response in the strongest of terms is, "God forbid." The strongest of Greek terms, "God forbid." By no means has the law been done away with, whether for Jew or Gentile, believer or unbeliever. Paul is unequivocal in his statement that the law of God remains. It's as if Paul, if he was living in our day today and he was had gone to undergrad, taken a class in Philosophy 101 or Logic 101, he could have dusted off that little Latin phrase, non sequitur, simply means it doesn't follow. He could have very easily brought that out and said it doesn't necessarily follow that if salvation is apart from the law, that the law is necessarily needs to be done away with. See, rather than being all too quick to jump to that conclusion, that in some senses the law is opposed to the gospel, Paul could be speaking of the law in more than one way, such that both senses are to be affirmed. And so what is often the case is that when we don't fully grasp an argument, when we haven't heard all the details, when we haven't fully comprehended what it is that someone is referring to, particularly someone who may understand something better than we do, we can very easily jump to conclusions. We're not in Paul's mind. There are two very distinct manners in which Paul talks about the law in our text alone. And remember that we this evening have 11 verses in front of us out of 433 verses that are in the entire letter. Our desire tonight is to begin to comprehend something of Paul's thought structure concerning God's law, and how it is, and we'll need to use some other text within Paul's letter to the Roman epistle. And just by using Paul's thought in Romans, even in distinction from all the rest of his writings, we will begin to see something of the marvel of how it is that he can say that we are no longer under the law, though the law is not done away with and overthrown. Let's summarize what we've seen from Paul's letter to the Romans so far. In verse 23 of our text, verse 21, the righteousness of God in salvation is now manifest apart from the law. We then saw in the very final verse, in verse 31, that yet salvation through faith does not overthrow the law. We saw also in chapter 6 and verse 14 that there is a sense in which we are not under the law, but now under grace. And in chapter 7 and verse 4 is that for believers have died to the law in dying with Christ. It's very clear tonight that we can see that Paul is wanting to emphasize and hold both of those truths together. On the one hand, the Christian is under grace, not under the law. On the other hand, the law is not done away with for the believer. This evening feels a little bit like us arriving at JFK for the first time. We are visitors to America, and we just landed in New York City in JFK, and we're here on vacation.
We have 1 week to see America, and in our excitement as we arrive, having landed in New York, we see our host for the first time, and it's with glee we say, "Show us America." Well, America is exceptionally large, geographically broad. It's so rich and diverse, the cultural diversity, and you need to understand something of the history of this nation. 1 week already, I'm beginning to feel for our host. This evening, I want us to, almost as if we travel up in an airplane, get to about 30,000 feet and survey the biblical terrain of God's law. We're going to stop off at a few destination points. We just have very little time for a massive, most rich and wonderful insight that God reveals to us in His Word concerning the law. And we will touch on a few destination points to help us grasp something of the richness that Paul is conveying to us in his letter to the Roman church. Our first destination is actually a little town called Definition. And to grasp what it is that Paul is actually saying, we firstly need a working definition of the law of God. We see in James chapter 1 and verse 25 that the law is spoken of in Scripture as a perfect law, a law of liberty. The Westminster Confession of Faith speaks of the law as a law, a perfect rule of righteousness. We're speaking here of the moral law. It's the very thing that reveals God's good and perfect will to us, that you and I may grasp the will of God. The law is not wicked. It is not bad in and of itself. Actually, it is good. And furthermore, the law is for our good. It spurs us on in accordance with how it is that actually God's made us. And this brings us to our second destination, and that is we find Paul writing in chapter 2 of his letter to the Romans in verse 14 and verse 15. He talks about the law of God has been written by God on our hearts. He has written the law of God on the hearts of believers and unbelievers. Actually, in Adam's creation, Adam was created by God with the law placed upon his heart. And in the law being placed upon his heart, he knew God's will. Remember that Adam was created upright. He was created righteous. And so this law informed him of God's will. Actually, we may speak of it as a universal law that was written upon his heart. It was a universal law that was comprehensive in terms of the world in which he lived, how he was to live. What's fascinating is that though this universal law was written upon his heart, we find in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 16 and verse 17, Moses writes of a particular law, a law that was appended or attached or concerns the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It was a particular law that brings a much needed insight into view, our third destination point, so to speak. Adam was not to eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of evil, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, as we saw last week. And it's right here that when we begin to understand what it is that Genesis chapter 2 is referencing, we have one of those kind of aha moments. We see something of what Paul sees. We see something that you and I may have missed. We actually, in our third destination point, in Genesis 2, we understand a central, much needed, architectural, structural insight into God's Word and how it is that God relates with all of humanity. And this particular law actually highlights the very covenantal relationship that God has with man. The relationship that God has with Adam before the fall was covenantly qualified, we might say. There was an arrangement, there was a promise that was given from God to Adam, and in his obedience he would gain that which God had extended to him, that which God had promised to him. The Westminster Confession of Faith helpfully defines this law as the law being a covenant of works, something that we spoke about last Sunday. In other words, the law here is functioning in a specific context prior to Adam's fall in sin. You see, at this time point, before Adam had fallen, with the covenant relationship that he had with God, grace is not in the picture. There is no faith that is needed. There is no need for a mediator or a savior, for there is no sin. What is in view with respect to the particular law attached to the tree was obedience, was to obey the law of God, and in him obeying that law, he would gain that which was promised by him, by God. But when Adam does sin, God very graciously, in his kindness and mercy, freely makes a second covenant. The first covenant, remember, is the covenant of works. The second covenant that God very graciously makes is called a covenant of grace. And it's within these two covenants, if we understand these two covenant structures, is that we will begin to understand the structural aspects of all of Scripture, how it is that God relates with man. See, every boy or girl, every male and female, of every tribe, of every tongue, every race, in all the earth, are to be understood in the light of those two covenants. We have two representatives, as I mentioned last week. We have Adam, who was the head of the covenant of works, a representative for his people. We have Christ, spoken of as the second and the last Adam, who is the head of the covenant of grace. There are two principles that are spoken of that inherit the promises. One is obedience, the other faith. And then there are two very different results that outplay on the basis of those representatives. In Adam's disobedience, there is condemnation and death. And in Christ's obedience, there is justification and eternal life for his people. And it's in this sense that Paul says, one is either under the law as a covenant of works, or one is under grace. Paul is referring in Romans chapter 6 and verse 14 to the law as a covenant of works, in which obedience, perfect obedience, would gain that which was promised. But as we saw last week, that is now an impossibility. As believers, we are no longer under the law in that regard. As believers, we are no longer under the law as a covenant of works. However, the law as a rule of life, as a moral rule that reflects God's will, is unchangeable. As God is unchangeable. And it cannot be done away with. And so far what we've seen is that man in his original creation, there was a universal law that was placed upon his hearts in which man knew God's will. He was created upright, and this law in his heart actually animated him. It spurred him on. It pressed him forward. As one who is righteous is that it pressed him forward wonderfully, the law of God, to obey God's will. And this law was, man was made very much in the image of God, and the law of God written upon his hearts reflected that. In Adam's sin, we saw last week that something of the image of God is lost. And the image of God being lost, what we find with respect to that law that was placed upon Adam's heart is it is darkened. The brilliance, the radiance of that law, the beauty of that law is now darkened. It's shadowed in virtue of Adam falling in sin and losing an aspect of the image of God. But when you and I are born again by the Spirit of God, that moral law, that perfect law of life and liberty is writ large again. And here we're going to fly to our next two cities. They actually happen to be in the very same state or province, which we might call grace, representative of the covenant of grace. Two cities, one region. The first is seen in Mount Sinai, when the moral law is given to Israel, God's old covenant people. It's given on two tablets of stone. It's commonly referred to as the Ten Commandments. What's important for us to grasp, friends, is the context in which that law was given. The verse right before, the one that precedes the Ten Commandments as laid out in Exodus chapter 20, beginning in verse 3, we find in verse 2 the following: I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt and out of the house of slavery. This, friends, is the language of redemption. This is the language of salvation. It's the language of deliverance from bondage, from the freedom of slaves, of those who have been called out of darkness, out of the world, into his glorious light, those who are called out to come and worship him. It's a call from God to worship. Egypt, remember, is a picture of the world. This is redemption language. The law given to the Israelites was not a law unto salvation, but it was a law writ large on external tablets of stone, revealing the perfect moral law, the rule of life for God's people. That which was shadowy on their hearts in virtue of sin was now clearly proclaimed again on two stony tablets for God's covenant people. That's our first city. We may call it Decalogue. But then there's a movement that we see in the history of redemption. There's a movement of the flow of God's purposes as they are unfolded in Scripture. And then we find in Pentecost, most wonderful outpouring of the Spirit. And at Pentecost, what's profound to note is there is a fulfillment of Joel 2:28, in that God would pour out his Spirit, but there is also a fulfillment of Jeremiah 31 and Ezekiel 36. And that is this, is that God would, by the Spirit, place his law on the inside, on our hearts, in God's covenant people. And so we find this movement in the covenant of grace. One people, two administrations of law within one people of grace. External two tablets written by the finger of God. Looking forward to the day in which the Spirit of God would be poured out because Christ is being glorified, and in the pouring out of the Spirit at Pentecost, the law of God, God's perfect will, his moral law, that law of life, would be writ large again on our hearts. No longer under the law as a covenant of works, though the law of God has not been done away with. Now remember, the law did not come into existence because of sin. The law was there prior to sin. in Adam's creation. And so this, in many senses, is a kind of whirlwind flight around the biblical terrain on the law, and how you and I can begin to look in and begin to grasp something of the structures, those deep structures that Paul is talking about, that at first glance, first appearance, it seems like Paul's contradicting himself. But Paul understands that that which informs the architectural structures that in which God refers to all of humanity, refers to that promise of life, is either by obedience in the covenant of works with first Adam, or is by grace, by salvation in Christ and Christ alone, and his obedience, and that we trust and rest upon him. Friends, the moral law never ever expires. We find in Matthew chapter 5, remember that wonderful Sermon on the Mount, Jesus himself said, "I have not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law." And he immediately begins to discuss how it is that we are obligated to the law in him fulfilling the law and not abolishing it. You know what's interesting is that neither Christ nor Paul are ever charged as being legalists. They're never ever charged of being legalists, though both are charged as those who have done away with the law. Friends, the law, the moral law of God, is of great use to both believer and to unbeliever. Paul goes on as to say in Romans chapter 8, in verse 3 and 4, he says that Christ condemns sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Christ fulfilled the law for us. And for those whom Christ fulfilled the law, the Spirit fulfills the law in us. In closing, I'd like to show us just one or two ways of how it is that the law is of great use for each one of us. In Romans chapter 7 and verse 12, we see Paul says that the law is holy, and the commandment is holy and righteous and good. And as the confession so beautifully states, that the law of God very sweetly complies with the gospel. Law is not opposed or antithetical to gospel. Only a misunderstanding of what it is that Paul is speaking of, or what God is revealing concerning the law and the gospel, would lead to such a conclusion. For believers, the moral law is a rule of life. It reveals God's law to us today, and so often it reveals God's will for us. And so often today, we ask questions concerning the will of God for my life, such as, what career should I pursue? If I get an opportunity to go and move to another city, God, is that your will? One of the things, I mean, that's another sermon on its own, and how it is that God sovereignly leads us and guides us in wisdom. One of the things that is frequently overlooked, a more basic reality, is how it is that God's law reveals his will for us. What is pleasing to him of how it is that we as sons and daughters of God are to walk. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 19 that neither circumcision counts for anything nor uncircumcision, but keeping the commandments of God. All of the commandments of God can be summed up as follows, as Christ taught us. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and will and all your soul and with all your mind. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. You know, Jesus very clearly says that if you love me, you will keep my commandments. Remember the great commission, the exhortation to the apostles. As they were to go and make disciples, disciples of all nations, every tribe, tongue, and nation. And part of that was to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, but also teaching them to obey all that I have commanded. This is the teaching of Christ. But how are we to do this? Are we to do this by love? It's by a faith that works by love. How are we to do this? By a faith that works by love. Galatians 5, 6. Paul says, love, this is in Romans 13 and verse 10, and I'm coming to a close. Love is the fulfilling of the law. We obey in submission to God's law and in love for him. This, friends, is what it looks like to walk in the Holy Spirit, or to walk by the Holy Spirit, and to bear fruit of the Holy Spirit. R.C. Sproul, following John Calvin's lead, notes the following. He says, the highest function of the law is its serving as an instrument for the people of God to give him honor and glory. And friends, tonight, may we be like the psalmist who delights in God's law, for by it we shall delight in what pleases God. May we meditate upon it, and in doing so, we will be excited by it, animated by it, spurred by it. Not external pressures and rules, but the very life of God by the Spirit and his will being revealed. Excited by the Spirit to obey it, and it shall show us also our sin, and how deep the very tentacles of sin go to the very depths of our heart, such that we are pointed to a great and a faithful Savior who shall forgive us and conform us by the Word in the Spirit to his image. God will strengthen you and conform you into the likeness of his Son. And when you and I see the beauty of the Lord and the deep structure that Paul has in view in his letter to the church in Rome, we will increasingly find great joy in the law and in fulfilling God's precepts in love, we shall truly glorify God and enjoy him forever. Let's pray. Oh, great God, what a marvel it is as we see the wonder of salvation in Christ alone. We thank you for the richness of your word. May we be a people who are awed at the wonder of your grace. And may we too be those who prize and delight in the very precepts of God and his law, that we would be those who, though imperfect in this age, are those who by faith obey our great Savior and the law of God. May we do this for the magnificence of your name. Help us, O God. You are so good and so faithful. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Receive the blessing of God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.